Namaste to one and all present here. Once again, I welcome you back in the science class. So, in your previous class, what we had done? We had done the summary of the chapter Conservation of Plants and Animals, in which we had discussed the basic terminology of that chapter. And after that, we had discussed the objective part in the form of fill in the blanks, multiple choice questions and match the following. Today we will take up the long question answers, in which first we will see the discussion of that question answers and then their explanation. So now let's start the discussion as well as the explanation of the chapter. Let's start the discussion of the question answers given in the exercise of the chapter Conservation of Plants and Animals. The very first question in part D, answer the following questions in brief, is how have urbanization and industrialization led to a large scale deforestation? Okay, did you understand the question? Now, urbanization and industrialization, two processes which leads to the increase in the deforestation, that you have to write that how they are causing increase in deforestation. First of all, about deforestation, we all know that overcutting of trees in an unplanned manner, it is known as deforestation. Then what is the meaning of urbanization and industrialization? Urbanization is the increasing population of the people living in town and cities. Urbanization, or we can say that due to economic growth and social growth, there is a migration of people from rural area to urban area. This is termed as urbanization. Now, what is the meaning of industrialization? The social and the economic change to bring the development in the society or in the country, it says that it is industrialization. So these two processes leads to the large scale of deforestation. Now we will see what will be the explanatory answer for this question. Urbanization and industrialization have resulted in large scale deforestation. The possible reasons are, first one, increase in population and their demand. First one, day by day the populations are increasing, and increase in population, the demand is also increasing. Hence, the land area requirement of that people is increased, which leads to the destruction of the forest. Number two, construction of houses, buildings, roads, flyovers, malls, etc. A country is said to be developed because of their roads structure, the flyovers and the number of malls. It shows their development. For this development they need the space on the land. And how do they get the space? Just by clearing the forest. So there are the two reasons, some more are there. Then the third one, for establishment of industries, day by day our need is also growing. To make our life more comfort, we are depending on many of the materials which makes our life convenient, and for that we need to set up different types of factories. So this is also one of the reason for the destruction of deforestation. Number four, raw materials to industries to make medicines, paper and furniture. We all know that we depend on forest from many years ago, that for different forest products. Timber, the wood, is the main product that we get from the forest. The paper pulp that we also get from the forest. So many of the raw materials we obtain from the forest, and hence we are destroying the, or we are cutting the trees. Number five, massive development project. In your book, that Tehri project and Narmada Valley project, the two examples are given there. So to do any of the development work, we need space, and hence the people are cutting the trees. So these are the five reasons which helps in urbanization and industrialization, and these two processes leads to the increase in the deforestation. Number two, question number two, a new species X is introduced in a forest. How is it likely to affect the species of the area? What happens if a new species is introduced in a forest? How it will affect the local species of that area? The answer is, the new species is likely to affect the local species in following manner. First of all, there will be competition for food and the other resources, food, shelter, etc. They will compete with each other for their struggle, for their existence. So, the first reason, there will be competition. Number two, preying on the native or the local species. If the introduced species is predator, it may kill the smaller animal of that particular area. Prey means killing of the local species. Hunting of that local species by the introduced species, as it may be a predator. So second one is your preying on native or local species. Number third, the introduced species may prevent the local species for reproduction. There may be a chance that reproduction may become abnormal in function due to introduction of the new species. Number four, may alter the food chain. There may be a change in the food chain. These are the four reasons which may happen due to introduction of new species in a particular area. Then question number three, what is a biosphere reserve? Name two biosphere reserves in India. During discussion also we discussed that what is the meaning of biosphere reserve. Once again I am here to explain you that what is the meaning of biosphere reserve. Biosphere reserves are the extended or protected land meant for the conservation of wild animals and plants. Earth is a biosphere. It is made up of three spheres, hydrospheres, atmospheres and the lithospheres. All the wildlife, all the historical places, all the habitats, all the ecosystems, when they all conserve it together, many of the studies can be done over there. It is a part of land and it helps in protecting the biodiversity. Biodiversity means various forms of life. It can be plant, it can be animals, or it can be any other historical objects. So biosphere reserves are the extended protected land meant for the conservation of wild animals and plants. It maintains the biological diversity of an area and restores the traditional life by protecting the historical objects and the habitat. Now two biosphere reserves in our country India. The two names I have written here. The first one is the Sundarbans, situated in West Bengal. Second one, Nanda Devi, it is in Uttarakhand. Question number four, under the part D, it is, how does the Red Data Book help in protecting biodiversity? Once again, the same term, Red Data Book. What is it? It is a document which stores all the informations regarding the endangered species, rare species or vulnerable species. How it will help in protecting biodiversity? See, the informations given in the Red Data Book, that which animals are in which status of or which animal are in which condition, whether they are extinct or going to be extinct, or very the status is very threatened, then we can have a watch on their activity. See, the Red Data Book is a document which includes the list of endangered and rare species of plants, animals and some other creatures which are at the verge means edge, which are almost about to extinct. It keeps a track record of about these animals. This is important for protecting biodiversity as it gives the indication of threat status and hence can be prevented. Means all the informations are given in Red Data book. So by taking the knowledge or information from this book, the possible steps can be taken to protect them from being extinct. Okay, see what I have written here once again. This is important for protecting biodiversity as it gives the indication of threat status and hence the possible steps can be taken to protect these animals from being extinct and can be prevented. Clear? Next question number 5. Why do some birds and animals migrate? Now just recall the migration topic. What is the meaning of migration? It is the seasonal movement of plants and animals from one place to another place. Now you just think, why do birds and animals move? There must be some reason. The possible reasons you all must be knowing. The very first reason is in search of food. In search of food, many birds and animals, they migrate from one place to another place. Second one, in search of the favorable climate. They may change their habitat, maybe for a smaller duration. They may come from their native place to some other place just to get the proper or favorable climatic conditions. Number three, for mating. M-A-T-I-N-G, or we say for breeding also. So these three are the possible reasons that says why birds and animals migrate from one place to another. Now see what I have written here. Some birds and animals migrate. The reasons are, first one, as usual, just now I dictated, in search of food. Number two, favorable climate and place. And number three, for breeding. Now question number 6. How do birds get helped in navigation while undertaking long distance flight? When they migrate from one place to another, how do they get the direction that where they have to go? Answer is, birds get help in navigation. This navigation we also use when we are going to visit some unknown place. Then we help the navigation key to get the direction. Birds also taking help or navigate themselves by one of the structure in their body. Birds get help in navigation while long distance migration with the help of a magnetic compass, which is a tiny mass of tissue located between their eyes and brain. There is a structure which behaves like a magnetic compass, which is very small in structure, or it is a mass of tissue which is located between the eyes and the brain of the birds, which help in navigation and to get the direction in their long distance migration. Question number 7. Distinguish between a national park and a wildlife sanctuary. This question also we had discussed in the previous class when we were discussing the short summary of the chapter. Once again, I'm giving you the answer, that this way you will write the differences. First, national park. The second one, wildlife sanctuary. In the national park, no human activities are allowed. Okay, no human activities. Wildlife sanctuary, some human activities may be allowed in wildlife sanctuary. Number two, the boundaries are fixed and defined. In the case of national park, the boundaries are fixed and defined. But in the case of wildlife sanctuaries, there are no fixed boundaries. That does not mean that they will enter the cities or the town. No, means within that wildlife sanctuaries, the animals, they do not have a proper boundaries. They can move freely. Number third, the national park mainly इट इज मेनली टू प्रोटेक्ट द फ्लोरा फौना एंड अदर ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ हिस्टोरिकल सिग्निफिकेंस इन टोटैलिटी द नेशनल पार्क प्रोटेक्ट्स द फ्लोरा फौना एंड होल हैबिटेट ऑफ द इकोसिस्टम वेयर एज द वाइल्ड लाइफ सेंचुरी द मेन एम इज ओनली टू प्रोटेक्ट दैट पर्टिकुलर फ्लोरा और फौना मीन्स ओनली प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स नो हैबिटेट Then in the case of national park, fourth difference I have written, it is not usually open for the general public. But wildlife sanctuary, it is open to the general public. Two more points are there. One point I gave you in our discussion that national park generally it is owned by the national government or state government also. Wildlife sanctuary, it can be owned by national government. State government or sometimes by private ownership also. Okay, this point I have not written. You can add the fifth one by rewriting these two points. Number six, the national park cannot be downgraded. Means the national park cannot be converted into sanctuary. But the wildlife sanctuary can be upgraded into national park. Did you get the point? The wildlife sanctuary can be upgraded into national park but the wildlife sanctuary cannot be downgraded means cannot be changed into sanctuary example I have written here in the case of national park we have Jim Corbett National Park and here which is in Uttarakhand and Bharatpur Bird Sanctuary which is in Rajasthan now part E let's discuss the part E explain how deforestation can result in droughts and floods. Meaning of droughts and flood, it is clear to you. Droughts, when there is no rainfall. Flood means when there is excess of water. Now, how it happens due to deforestation? Let's discuss. Cutting of trees in a large scale is known as deforestation. This is very clear to you. Now, how it leads to droughts and floods? Number one. Deforestation can result in droughts because less trees means more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Now see, first of all, we have reduced the number of trees due to deforestation. Trees are the very good recipient of the carbon dioxide, but due to their indiscriminate cutting, now there is very less recipient or in further days, there will be no recipient of carbon dioxide. But we are the donor of the carbon dioxide. We and the animals, we release the carbon dioxide from respiration process. Now what happens? The carbon dioxide is not taken by the plants. It stays in the atmosphere. This leads to the global warming because carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. It maintains the earth's temperature or it maintains the warmth of the atmosphere but the increase in the carbon dioxide it will increase the temperature of the earth atmosphere which leads to the global warming the increase in temperature disturbs the water cycle and droughts occur the increase in temperature disturbs the water cycle the rainwater cycle will be disturbed and hence it will result in drought number two Deforestation results in increased instances of flooding as there is a lack of trees that bind the soil and absorb water. From very junior classes, we all are reading this many times that the root binds the soil. When there is no root, there is no point binding of the soil and the soil erosion will take place. Hence, what will happen? The trees will not absorb the water and it will not go into the groundwater level. The depth of the rivers are also decreasing due to soil erosion. The soil may get transferred and it will deposit into the river bed. Hence what happened? The depth of river will decrease which again lead to the flood. The depth of rivers are decreasing due to deposition of soil into the river bed. So these two are the reasons which is occurring due to the deforestation. Number two, extinction of tiger can destabilize the entire forest ecosystem and results in large scale loss of biodiversity. If the tiger is extinct, now the tiger is in endangered position. If you will not save the tiger, then may a day come, then tiger will become extinct and the coming generation, they will read the tiger as an extinct animal. So, if the extinction will happen, then how it will cause unbalance in the forest and how it will result in the loss of biodiversity. See what I have written here. If the numbers of tiger decreases, then the herbivore species will increase at a higher rate, which will also deplete the grass and plants of the forest. The scavengers will also get affected, as there will be no dead remains of animals killed by tiger. Hence, the decrease of tiger population will harm the ecosystem of the forest. Now, try to understand from the simple food chain. Grass is eaten by deer and the deer is eaten by tiger. According to the question, the tiger is extinct. Tiger is a carnivorous animal and deer is the herbivorous animal. Now, when there is no tiger, the tiger is extinct. Now, what will happen? Automatically, the herbivores, deer in this food chain, it will increase their number, because the predator is already dead. No tiger is there to eat the or kill the deer. The deer numbers will increase, which will continuously feed on the grass producers. Clear to you? Now, what will happen? There may a change or drastically decrease in the producers number. Clear? This is the first problem. If there is no tiger, means no hunting, no killing. Now, the dead remains will not be there. Hence, the scavengers who were depending on the hunted animals by the tiger, the scavengers will not get the food to eat. So, scavengers will also get affected if one of the component of this food chain will get disturbed. In short, all the components of the food chain, they play an important role in maintaining the balance in the nature, or to maintain a balance in the food chain to save the biodiversity in the ecosystem. That's why it is said that extinction of tiger should be saved. This should be protected. Otherwise, it will create a lot of problem in the ecosystem. So, all the members of the ecosystem, they play an important role. See, if one of the component will get disturbed, whole cycle will get disturbed and it will harm the ecosystem of the forest. Question number 3. Why are endemic species at a greater risk of becoming extinct? List the human action. By mistake I wrote harmful. Just read it human. List the human action related causes that are responsible for their extinction. First of all, once again, just recall the term endemic species. The species which are basically or restricted to a particular area, they are very prone to become extinct. What are the reasons? Answer is, endemic species are at a greater risk of becoming extinct due to, first one, human activities. Number 2, lack of adaptability. Many human activities are there which leads to the extinction, which may cause the extinction of endemic species. We will discuss later on. The lack of adaptability means these animal species are restricted to a particular area. So, when they will be brought to another surroundings or atmosphere, they may not adjust, and hence there may be a chance of their extinction. So, these two are the main points, the human activities and the lack of adaptability, which may cause or which brings the endemic species at the verge of the extinction. Now, what are the human action which are responsible for the extinction of the endemic species? First one, loss of habitat. We all know that the deforestation,
regularly we are cutting the trees, their habitat are destroying. So the loss of habitat means there may a chance that their species will become extinct. Number 2, over exploitation. What is the meaning of over exploitation? When living organisms are hunted to the extent that their population is not able to maintain itself, means continuously the any species are being hunted. Hence what will happen, that hunted species will not able to maintain their race, and hence it will cause the extinction. That is known as over exploitation. Number 3, introduced species. Introduction of new species can have a significant impact on endemic species, as the new species may prey on or compete for resources with existing species. We discussed in the previous questions that what happened if the new species are introduced in the ecosystem. The introduced species may kill the local or native species, or they may compete for their existence, and the weaker may must be dying. The number 4, ecosystem disruption. Now what is the meaning of ecosystem disruption? There may be a change in the ecosystem. The living organisms in an ecosystem are often linked together. This link might be a food chain. Just now we had discussed, if any of the components of the food chain will get disturbed, whole ecosystem will become what? Unbalanced. So these are the reasons which may bring the endemic species in the status of being extinct. Number 4, the growing human population poses a grave threat to biodiversity, justify the statement. Our population is growing drastically, and hence it is also a big threat to the biodiversity. How? See, an increase in human population is affecting biodiversity by taking up more land, which threats the lives of plants and animals. We need more land for our many more works are there. So it threats the lives of the plants and animals. Number 2, to create residential places for human beings. To bring build up the buildings, apartments, we need land. Hence trees are being cut. Number 3, more demand of natural resources, hence depleting. We are completely dependent on forest for timber, for paper pulp, for medicines, spices, etc., which also leads to the loss of biodiversity. One example, day by day the population is increasing. If we are depending continuously on seafood, now what will happen? Obviously the seafood resources will deplete. So these are the 3 reasons. One more is the migration of birds and animals. The migration of birds and animals, it also give a threat to loss of biodiversity in the nature. Number 6 question, difference between extinct, endangered and vulnerable species. Very simple question, you all know it very well. Let's see. Extinct, these are the plant or animal which is now not found anywhere in the world, means the existence is no more. Example, dodo or the passenger pigeon. Caribbean monk seal is also one of the example. Endangered species, a species of plant or animal which is at a high risk of extinction in the near future. If the unfavorable conditions persist, these animals very soon will become extinct. Example, blue whale, giant panda or tiger. Vulnerable, a plant or an animal which runs the risk of soon becoming endangered and finally extinct in time to come. Vulnerable, they are also in a danger state. First, they may come in endangered group, and after sometimes, finally they will become extinct. Cheetah and the lion. These 2 examples I have given in vulnerable species. Last question of this chapter. List 5 ways in which you as an individual can contribute to conserving forest and wild life. How will you help your nature to maintain a balance? What should be the duties should be done by us to protect the environment. First of all, by planting more and more trees. We should be promise to ourselves that we should plant at least one tree in 1 year. Number two, by reducing wastage of paper. As I am always preferring to write both the sides of the copy, just to reduce the wastage of paper. Number three, by creating awareness among the people to conserve forest and wildlife. Number four, by avoiding destruction of forest. Number five, by optimum or by limiting the utilization of forest products. So if these five responsibilities can be fulfilled by us, we will be able to protect our ecosystem in a very beautiful manner. So this way we have finished all the question answers of this chapter. Do it in your copy and just write down the queries if still you have in your notebook and ask me. We will meet in the next class. Bye bye.